The word of the Lord says this: to the elders among you, I appeal as a fellow elder, a witness of Christ's sufferings, and one who also will share in the glory to be revealed. Be shepherds of God's flock that is under your care, serving as overseers, not because you must, but because you are willing, as God wants you to be, not greedy for money, but eager to serve, not lording it over those entrusted to you, but being examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the crown of glory that will never fade away. Young men, in the same way, be submissive to those who are older. All of you, clothe yourselves with humility toward one another, because God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that he may lift you up in due time. Cast all your anxiety on him, because he cares for you. Be self-controlled and alert. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, looking for someone to devour. Resist him, standing firm in the faith, because you know that your brothers throughout the world are undergoing the same kind of sufferings. And the God of all grace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ, after you have suffered a little while, will himself restore you and make you strong, firm, and steadfast. To him be the power forever and ever. Amen. Let's bow our heads. Father, may this word that we have read this morning be powerful to us. May it speak to us, and may you be revealed in our lives through it. Help us to be true and accurate to the interpretation of your scriptures. We pray for your spirit to increase in our presence this morning, and for our spirit and our presence to decrease, so that you would be honored and glorified. We ask these things in Christ's name. Amen. I read through this. I wonder if you just kind of went, Scott, what in the world is going on here? Why are we reading out of this passage? You see, the first four verses of this passage is written to what? To the elders of the church. And we're talking about discipleship. Why are we talking about this passage that's written to the elders of church? Well, if you would turn back to 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 1, the first verse in this book, Peter writes these words: to God's elect, strangers in the world, scattered throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia, and so on and so on. Peter wasn't specifically addressing this group, this book, to one specific group of people. He was addressing it to people all over the world at that time, in many different places. It was written to believers. But then we get to verses 5 through 11. You're going, okay, we're talking about discipleship, but verse 5 specifically says, young men, you are to do this. Why are we studying this passage in relation to discipleship if it's addressed specifically to elders and young men? I'll be honest with you. Most pastors who do messages or sermon series on discipleship are not going to talk out of 1 Peter chapter 5, and that's okay. The reason we're doing it is because I believe the lessons in this passage transcend just elders and transcend just young men. The messages in here about leadership and being humble to God are essential to understanding what discipleship means in our lives, and therefore that's where we are studying that. So I just want to get that out of the way so we're on the same page this morning. But before we get into it too much, I want to tell you a story. This story is about something I experienced Friday mid-morning. I went down to the Great American Outdoor Show in Harrisburg, PA at the Farm Show Complex, right? And some of you guys are like, yeah, right? Another was like, here we go again. But what I saw at the Great American Outdoor Show was one of the greatest marketing ploys in the history of marketing that I've ever seen in my entire life. The people that had this one booth set up and this one stand set up knew their target audience better than anybody had ever seen. It was back in the outfitters section in this big great hall down in the one corner was, and I totally forgot to take a picture of it because it was one of the greatest things I ever saw. It was a dune buggy. And I'm talking like a full-fledged dune buggy with one person driving it, sits down in. And when I say full-fledged dune buggy, the dune buggy is probably the size of my pickup truck. One person sits down in, and there was two seats elevated above and behind it. For $750 a person, and that might sound like a lot to you, but just listen to me here. For $750 a person, you could book a hunt on this dune buggy in the state of Georgia for one night. You and your friends could hunt out of this dune buggy with night vision goggles and fully automatic rifles mounted on turrets behind the driver with unlimited ammunition and unlimited hogs that you could kill. And I just went, you have got to be kidding me. Like, I'm looking at that thing, that's the coolest thing I've ever seen. Like, it just keeps getting better, right? It's not that you're riding in a dune buggy, but you're riding in a dune buggy at night with night vision and shooting these automatic weapons with unlimited ammunition and unlimited hogs that you can kill, and they butcher them for you. And I'm thinking, what kind of person would do this? And then it goes to my mind, every man who's ever wanted to shoot a gun would want to do this, including every woman. And then I have this vision of people in my church, like imagining Bob Bechtel and Brad Guthrie sitting on these turrets, shooting these weapons with their little space ball hats on. And then I'm thinking, you know what? I wouldn't even trust some of the elders. I'm thinking about my message, like, I wouldn't trust Ernie and Dan Force to do it, right? Like, I just having these visual representations. Because every one of us, no matter how we started, we'd be going, man, this is really cool. And it doesn't matter if you're shooting a hog or a stump that looks like a hog or a figment of your imagination that looks like a hog. You're going to be letting it fly, right? I mean, this... Why, Scott, why are you telling us this story, right? Because this is an example. When I look at that, I see what starts out as good. Can you imagine what this company pays for insurance, by the way? What starts out as, man, this is going to be a great night, I can only imagine rapidly loses all form of control once the wheels hit the dirt, right? Once the bullets start flying, it is just mass chaos. But our scripture today says something different, almost the antithesis of what the illustration I just told you I would imagine. Verse 8 says, be self-controlled and alert. We are to be aware of our surroundings and our circumstances. We are to be on the lookout for the devil's schemes. You see, so often in our lives, we are willing to throw caution to the wind. We're willing to give in to temptations and the mantras that we hear uttered so often in the world around us that sound so good, but are simply not biblical and are often contrary to what we find based in the scriptures in this Bible. Let me give you a couple examples. And I've used this one before. Follow your heart. It sounds so good. It sounds so comforting. It sounds so warm and fuzzy. And yet, if we believe what's written in the Bible, the heart is full of evil. The heart is scheming. God wants you to be happy. God wants you to be happy. A God who loves you, of course, is going to want you to be happy, right? Does that mean if you're not happy, your relationship with God is based upon your emotions? Because that's the road that you start traveling down if you think that God wants you to be happy all the time. That's very contradictory to scriptures. God won't give you more than you can handle. Guys, if God wouldn't give you more than you can handle, you wouldn't have a need for God. Everything happens for a reason. You have to learn to love yourself before you can learn to love others. And the list goes on and on and on. But verse 8 says what? Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. Resist him standing firm in the faith. If you believe what is written in your Bible, if you believe this to be the inspired word of God, his revelation to you, then you must understand that there is a war going on. A war that is unseen. But like I said, if you don't believe what's written in the Bible, this is completely irrelevant. But if you believe what's written in here, then you must understand there is a war going on for your soul that is every bit as real as the air that you are breathing right now, as the family that you have at home, as the fact that you are sitting in this sanctuary listening to me talk right now. There is a war going on that is so real and is so tangible, and it is a war for your soul. And war is never a pretty thing, is it? I mean, does anybody go, you know what? I think I'm going to kick back, relax tonight, watch the first 27 minutes of Saving Private Ryan. You know? Watch him storming the beaches at Normandy there. That'll be nice and relaxing. Right? Nobody says that because it's a sin, because war is ugly. And war is ugly in the scriptures. 1 Samuel chapter 15, verse 3. Listen to the words that are written. Now go attack the Amalekites and totally destroy everything that belongs to them. And I don't know if you understand this, but this is well before the age of drones flying over and dropping bombs, or people shooting each other with guns and pistols. This is when combat was literally hand-to-hand. Listen to the words. Go and destroy everything that belongs to them. Do not spare them. Put to death men, women, children, infants, cattle, sheep, camels, and donkeys. Deuteronomy chapter 2, verse 34 says, at that time we took all his towns and completely destroyed them, men, women, and children. We left no survivors. Why? Because war is ugly. And war is horrible. And let's be honest, for many of us, war is beyond our comprehension. It is for me. I've never experienced it. I've never been to something like it. I've never been through something like that. So to say I understand it is false. I can't even wrap my mind around what war would be like. But I can tell you for a fact that there is a war that is unseen that is being waged for each and every soul of every person that walks the face of this earth, if you believe what's written in this book. I bring that up because the word picture that's painted in this passage may not be one specifically of war, but it's along those lines. What Peter is writing here is that you're being hunted by an apex predator, right? The devil prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. Like when I was at the sportsman show on Friday, there were some pretty cool mounts and some pretty cool lion mounts. And if you've ever been to like Cabela's in Hamburg, the one lion mount back there is phenomenal. And when we were down at Disney a month ago or so, whenever that was, we went through Animal Kingdom. You took a safari tour, and I took some pictures. The lions were out the morning we went through, which doesn't happen often, we were told. But they're like, it looked like a scene from The Lion King. I mean, the rocks are up, and the male is laying, and a couple of the lionesses are laying around, and they're looking out. But where our car stopped at one point, right, it was great, because the lions were on these rocks about where the back of the sanctuary is at, and there was the herd of kudu, these African game animals behind us, directly behind us. So the lions are just laying there staring. But it looked like they were looking right at us. That's not a comfortable feeling. Like, even though I know, you know, they can't get to us, but I've seen Jurassic Park. Accidents happen, right? You know, like, you can't explain it. Life goes on. But I got some great pictures on my phone, and it runs right through you. Their eyes are just running right through you. And when you get to see them close up, what you'll notice about the lions, what I always notice and blows me away more than anything, is the veins running through their bodies. Like, the muscles are one thing, but when you see the veins popping out down their legs, across their chest, across their back, you realize that this is not an animal that you want to play with. This is not an animal that you want to mess with a whole lot. These lions are basically one big ball of muscle. And I was having a conversation with somebody recently. Look, I'm not a lion guy per se. If you know me, you know I'm a shark guy, great white shark guy. I've always, since elementary school, I've been fascinated with great white sharks. I just have been. Another apex predator. If I had the opportunity, I would gladly jump in a shark cage in great white shark waters to view them underwater. In the cage, okay? You got that part, right? Okay? Like, that would be just a high moment in life. I can't even imagine doing it. But when I was talking to this person, right, the conversation went something along these lines. I made it abundantly clear that being attacked and killed by an apex predator is very low on my list of ways I would choose to die. I would not want that by any stretch of the imagination. And maybe you're thinking, Scott, you're getting a little gory. Bring it back in here this morning. And that's okay. Because this picture that's being painted here in verse 8 is Satan looking for ways to steal, kill, and destroy your soul. He is looking for ways to actively keep you from God. And Satan is very good at what Satan does. I don't think we often give Satan enough credit for what he does. But we are not to be afraid of Satan, are we? Well, Jesus says these words in Matthew chapter 10, verse 28. I jumped ahead of myself a little bit there. Jesus says, "Do not be afraid of those who can kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather be afraid of the one who can destroy both soul and body in hell." So what Christ is saying is we need to look out for Satan. Don't be afraid of the one who can just kill the body, but be afraid of the one who can kill the body and the soul. And I think we can all agree that if we hop into a den of lions, or if we go swimming in the open water with great white sharks, our lifespan's going to diminish rapidly, pretty quickly, probably. My question is simply this, then, though. Why do we not treat Satan accordingly? If Satan is akin to a lion in this passage, why do we treat him as though he's a house cat? Why do we treat him as though we can control him and manipulate him and let him do what we want as long as we appease him to an extent? You see, this is not a passive wait and see type of scripture. Satan is actively looking to steal, kill, and destroy. In Ephesians chapter 6, we are instructed to put on the full armor of God so that we can stand up against the ploys of Satan in our lives, against the devil's schemes. Adam and Eve fell victim to Satan in the garden, didn't they? "You will certainly not die," the serpent said to the woman. "For God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened and your will, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." So what did they do? They ate. John chapter 8, verse 44, Christ says, "He," Satan, "was a murderer from the beginning, not holding to the truth, for there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks his native language, for he is a liar and the father of lies." You see, the first step to defeating Satan is acknowledging that he exists in the first place. He's not some fantasy. He's not some fairy tale. He's not some horror movie that you watch late at night. But make no mistake, if you comprehend who Satan is, you should have a very healthy fear of who Satan is. But not so much that you become paralyzed of him. Why is that? Because you should also know Jesus Christ. Let me say it again. You should never be paralyzed by the fear of Satan if you have a relationship with Christ. One of my favorite scenes in the movie, The Passion of the Christ. And again, it's not a movie that you watch to feel good about, you know, things all the time. You can appreciate Christ's sacrifice for you, but it's not a happy movie. It is, but it's not. You get where I'm coming from? But I love the first scene when Jesus is praying in the garden, and he is agonizing over the task that's laid out for him. And he is praying, and he says, "Father, if this be your will, take this cup from me, but not your will, but mine be done." And the picture that is used in the movie is Satan in the corner of the garden watching Christ, thinking he's got Jesus exactly where he wants him. And the snake crawls out from under Satan's robe and goes over and kind of torments Christ as he is prone on the ground. And what does Jesus do to accept the will of the Father? He gets up and he steps on the head of the snake, absolutely crushing and destroying it. That's what I love. And that one scene is symbolic of Christ's entire life, death, and resurrection, isn't it? And so while I look at that and I go, yeah, I want to be afraid of the snake, but I also serve the one who steps on the head of the snake and has stepped on the head of the snake so I don't have to fear the snake anymore. Does that make sense? You all understand where I'm coming from here? That is why you are instructed not to give in to Satan, but to resist him. As disciples of Christ, you are not held captive by your fears and temptations of Satan. You are released from them and you are held firm in the love of Christ. That means that you are free to live in the faith and knowledge of Jesus and his love for you. It also means, think about this, that you're free to get rid of all your preconceived notions, all your ideas of what you think it means to be a disciple of Christ, and what the American dream of Christianity has turned into, and humbly lead life as a servant, leader of Christ according to his word. Let's get into this a little bit further. Let me break down what I'm trying to get across here. You see, to paraphrase the early verses of this passage, it says a servant leader must lead humbly in accordance with the example of Jesus Christ himself. That's the crux of verses 2 and 3 and 5 through 7. Leading humbly. Be shepherds of God's flock that is under your care, serving as overseers, not because you must, but because you are willing, as God wants you to be, not greedy for money, but eager to serve, not lording it over those entrusted to you, but being examples to the flock. Verse 5, in the same way, be submissive to those who are older. All of you, clothe yourselves with humility toward one another, because God opposes the proud but gives grace to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that he may lift you up in due time. Cast all your anxiety on him, Because he cares for you. You see, it's interesting that Peter wrote this passage. And that is the advice that he is giving, because that is the man that he has become through the working of the Holy Spirit in his life. You see, understand that this Peter that wrote this passage was the same Peter that we find in the book of John, chapter 13, who attempted to deny Christ the privilege of washing his feet. Remember that? The Last Supper? They're sitting around. Christ gets out the water. He gets out the bowl. He gets out the cloth. And he goes up to Peter. And what does Peter say? He came to Simon Peter and said to him, "Lord, are you at this time going to wash my feet?" And Jesus replied to him this way, "You do not realize now what I am doing, but later you will understand." "No," said Peter, "you shall never wash my feet." Jesus answered, unless I wash you, you have no part with me." Then Simon Peter replied, "Not just my feet, but my hands and my head as well." This Peter that we see in John chapter 13, this Peter that initially refused to let Christ wash his feet out of some perverted sense that the Son of God should be served, not serving, when Jesus said the exact opposite. Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve. That's the Peter that wrote this book about serving and being humble. You see, this is the same Peter that we see such amazing servant humility and leadership exuded in the Garden of Gethsemane, that he chose to cut off the ear of one of the guards that was attempting to apprehend Christ. Do you understand that for Christ to do what he, to Christ to achieve what he came to do, he needed to be arrested in the garden that night? Peter attempted to intervene and keep it from happening. What was Jesus' response? "Put your sword away. Shall I not drink the cup the Father has given me?" You see, this same Peter who for so long didn't understand God's will and his desire for his life is the same Peter that we find in chapter 5 today instructing others to lead humbly. You see, isn't it often that we look at ourselves and we think, you know what, for God to use me, I really need to be a finished product. I need to have all the I's dotted, the T's crossed. I need to look good. I need to act right. I need to know the right stuff. I need to be able to communicate properly. I need for everybody to understand clearly what's being said. And I need to know every answer to every question that there ever was about Christianity before I can effectively go and minister to others. Because if I don't, what if somebody asks me something that I don't know? Then I will misrepresent the entire faith. So I got to get all my stuff together before I properly serve Christ. I need to be that finished product. Isn't Peter's life a great example that you don't have to be a finished product? Let me phrase that. Peter's life is a great example that you don't have to be a finished product. Peter made plenty of mistakes. Peter continually came up short after literally walking and talking and living with Christ for years. He fell short on the measuring stick, but he chose to continue to be a disciple that was actively following and seeking Christ. So mistakes were made, mistakes were going to be made, but we're going to brush ourselves off, we're going to get up, and we're going to keep on trying to be a disciple. Sometimes Peter succeeded, sometimes Peter did not. But in the same breath, there's one thing we need to learn from Peter, and it's simply this. One aspect of Peter's faith that we should always emulate is Peter's passion. Peter was passionate about Christ. Peter was passionate about his faith. Peter was passionate about his ministry. And it's this passion that actually explains so many of the slip-ups. Peter didn't want Christ to wash his feet because Peter was passionate about Jesus. Peter didn't want Christ to be taken in the garden that night because he was passionate about being a disciple of his, and he did not want to be separated from his leader. Peter was passionate. And our passions consume us, don't they? I mean, our passions dominate our thought lives. I think back about 14 and a half years ago to the week leading up to my marriage, the week leading up to my wedding. And if you can remember, that was shorter for some of you, slightly longer for others. The week leading up to your wedding, what did you think about? It was like, man, I can't wait to get up and go to work tomorrow morning, right? See, my passion was bent on the fact that I was going to be marrying my wife that next week. And so every thought that I had that week focused around what? That event that it was leading up to. That's what I was passionate about. And our passions dominate our thoughts. What do you think about when you have time to contemplate? What do you think about in the silence? Our passions dominate a large majority of our time. For those of you who don't know, I consider myself a runner. But when I read about the training regimens of elite runners, I feel ashamed, embarrassed, and slightly humiliated to call myself a runner. You see, I'm not putting in 100 to 200 miles every week in training. That's what the elite runners do, just in case you weren't sure, which equates to more than a marathon a day. I'm not devoting 2 to 4 hours of my daily schedule to running. I'm not tracking my mileage. I'm not tracking my effort. I'm not tracking my heart rate. And I'm definitely not tracking my caloric consumption. But that's what the elite runners do. Because our passions take a large majority of our time. Our lives often revolve around our passions, not the other way around. So what do you do when you have the choice to do something? Because that's going to indicate where your passion lies. But Peter writes this, stand firm in the faith. Verse 9, what does it mean to stand firm in the faith? It means we need to read and heed verses 8 and 9, because that's really the big part of this passage for me. Be self-controlled and alert. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, looking for someone to devour. Resist him, standing firm in the faith, because you know that your brothers throughout the world are undergoing the same kind of sufferings. This passage is trained around this idea that we need to be self-controlled and alert, that Satan is prowling around like a lion looking to devour you. And then it's followed up by the idea that what? We need to be inspired by the example of other Christians around the world undergoing the same kind of sufferings. But maybe you're sitting there thinking to yourself, like I did when I read this passage, how in the world does that translate to our faith in America today? To be honest with you, and quite frank and open, I don't think it does. I don't think we have any clue, and I'm just being honest with you. I don't think we have any idea, being Christians in America, what suffering really is for our faith. I don't think we have any idea what it means to be marginalized or oppressed for our faith. I really don't. And I'm not saying that to hurt anybody's feelings. I'm not saying that there's not things we don't feel bad about or things like we're getting oppressed about. What I'm saying is, in the grand scheme of things, we have it pretty good. We have absolutely no way to wrap our minds around the kind of suffering that Christians are enduring around the globe, because that's what Peter's writing about here. If you want to know, if you've got the guts, I would challenge you, go to Voice of the Martyrs. Get a free subscription. They'll send you a monthly pamphlet. Not a pamphlet, it's like a newsletter on Christians that are being persecuted around the world. And it's not... Again, I'm not trying to minimize this, but please understand, it's not because they're not allowed to pray in school. It's not because they're not allowed to wear a t-shirt to school. It's not because they're not allowed to do the things that we think can be oppressive at times. It's because their lives are literally under attack because of their faith, which is so much more than we see on a daily basis. Guys, I bring this up because discipleship, ultimately, hear me this. This is the last week we're going to be talking about discipleship, and I'm going a little bit long. Discipleship is ultimately a choice that you're going to make in your relationship with Christ. Maybe you're thinking about it, you're going, you know, Scott, over the last 4, 5, 6 weeks, however long you've been talking about this, you haven't given us a lot of specifics. You haven't given us, this is what we need to do to be disciples of Christ. You're not given the ABCs. You're not given the steps we need to take. And you know what? You're exactly right. I'm talking in broad generalizations, because what I'm talking about today is going to determine whether you choose to be a disciple or not. It's a choice you need to make. I can't give you steps to take to get you there. If you are passionate about something, you follow something. You put time into something. You give effort into something. Having A, B, and C does not make you a better disciple. If you're passionate about God, you're going to get into this book. You're going to read through it. You're going to delve into it. You're going to understand about it. You're going to talk about it. It's going to invade every aspect of your life. You see, there's a big difference between being a believer and a disciple. Big difference between being a believer and a disciple. It's like the difference between going to a game or playing in the game. All of us, large majority of us, watched at least some part of the Super Bowl last Sunday night. We weren't at the game, but we watched the game, and lots of people watch the game. And we can sit around and talk about the game and all the negative stuff that happened in the game, right? But didn't the players on the field have a little bit more invested in it than us? I mean, we showed up, we started eating, 9 o'clock in the morning and ate the rest of the day. We turned on the game for the commercials sometimes, we turned on the game for the game sometimes, but we watched the game. See, the players' preparation for the game started 2 weeks ago when they made it to the game. Their eating habits, their sleeping habits, their training habits. The day before when they went to bed, what they ate that day, what time they got to the field, how they prepared themselves, mind, body, and soul for that game. The players on the field had a far different experience than you and I or anybody at that game had. Are you going to choose to allow God to actively use your life to further his kingdom and his goals? Or are you going to choose to live for yourself, your desires and your pleasures? It's a simple choice. But it is a choice, hear me, that has become blurred by the American dream that is dominated by prosperity and pleasure. Dietrich Bonhoeffer wrote these words back in the early part of the 19th century. Earthly goods are given to be used, not collected. In the wilderness, God gave Israel the manna every day, and they had no need to worry about food and drink. Indeed, if they kept any manna over until the next day, it went bad. In the same way, the disciple must receive his portion from God every day. If he stores it up as a permanent possession, he spoils not only the gift, but himself as well, for he sets his heart on accumulated wealth, and makes it a barrier between himself and God. Where our treasure is, there our trust, our security, our consolation, and our God. Hoarding is idolatry. Billy Graham said it this way. He said, salvation is free, but discipleship costs everything we have. Whew, that's good. Salvation is free, but discipleship costs us everything. William Carey writes, I'm not afraid of failure. I'm afraid of succeeding at things that don't matter. And Bonhoeffer had this other quote. So many people come to church with a genuine desire to hear what we have to say, yet they are always going back home with the uncomfortable feeling that we are making it too difficult for them to come to Jesus. Tough stuff. Tough stuff. I went on the Voice of the Martyrs website this morning, and I pulled this up. Voice of the Martyrs website says, in 40 nations around the world today, Christians are being persecuted for their faith. Some of these nations, it is illegal to own a Bible, to share your faith, to change your faith, or to teach your children about Jesus. Those who boldly follow Christ in spite of government edict or radical oppression can face harassment, arrest, torture, and even death. You know what's amazing about this? Is that Christians continue to meet and worship. Christians continue to witness for Christ, and the church in restricted nations is growing. If this isn't challenging to you, I don't know what is. You see, they list areas of the world where Christians face persecution. Listen to it. Here's the list they give. Afghanistan, Algeria, Azerbaijan, Bangladesh, Belarus, Bhutan, Brunei, Burma, Chiapas in Mexico, China, Colombia, Comoros, Cuba, Egypt, Eritrea, Ethiopia, Gaza in the West Bank, India, Indonesia, Iran, Iraq, Jordan, Kuwait, Kyrgyzstan, Laos, Lebanon, Libya, Malaysia, Maldives, Mindanao, Philippines, Mauritania, Morocco, Nepal, Nigeria, North Korea, Oman, Pakistan, Qatar, Saudi Arabia, Somalia, Sri Lanka, Sudan, Syria, Tajikistan, Tibet, Tunisia, Turkey, Turkmenistan, United Arab Emirates, Uzbekistan, Vietnam, and Yemen. Anybody hear U.S. on that list? See, these are places where they can be actively persecuted. For what? For teaching their children about Christ. For owning a Bible. But what's really challenging is that they can be just the same for sharing their faith. And they continue to do it. How many of us have shared our faith in the last week? month, year, decade. You see, that's discipleship. That's being passionate about what God has told us to do. Verses 8 through 11, be self-controlled and alert. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. Resist him, standing firm in the faith, because you know that your brothers throughout the world are undergoing the same kind of sufferings. And the God of all grace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ, after you have suffered a little while, will himself restore you and make you strong, firm, and steadfast. To him be the power forever and ever. Amen. I'm sorry I'm going a little long today, but this is good stuff, and it is challenging, and I hope you don't feel you don't leave here today feeling a little bit uncomfortable. I'm going to end with this illustration. Yesterday morning, I got up shortly after the crack of dawn and took my new dog, Moses. Some of you guys have met Moses. Moses we've had for about 4 or 5 months now, I believe. He looks just like Misty, except on steroids. I mean, he's almost an identical replication, about 30 pounds bigger, taller, wider, longer. Moses is a lab hound mix, and I've taken Moses out in the trail with me a couple times, and I was going out to run the trails yesterday morning. I thought, well, let's take Moses out in the snow. And so Moses sleeps on the floor in Luke's bedroom, so I open the floor. I open the door to Luke's room. Luke's still asleep. And normally I say, hey, Moses, you want to go for a run? Up and out. Yesterday morning, I opened the door. I looked at him. He looked up at me, and I went like this. I raised my eyebrows. Boom, up the door, and out he goes, right? He knew what was up because I had my running stuff on and everything. Goes to the door, tails wagging, this, that, and the other thing. We hop in the truck. We drive the trail. And it was tough sledding yesterday on the trail. And what I mean, it would have been actually easier to sled on the trail yesterday. I mean, we were breaking trail for a lot of times, 6-8 inches of snow, you know, feet are soaking wet, stuff like that. And I thought, let's do the boulder field. This would be a lot of fun. We got to the boulder field, and we got not even an eighth of the way up, and the poor dog is just, you know, and he's tearing it up. He's going all over the place, but he was very hesitant and tentative, you know, and he was kind of whining and fussing. And so we got off the boulder field, which still took a lot of work to get over to the side. Now we're bushwhacking up through the middle of the woods to get to the top of the mountain to go back down the other side and out. And to make a long story short, we were about a quarter mile from the truck, and he's always in front of me. Like, it's like a little kid, you know? Like, my kids, when we go hiking, argue over who goes first. He can't stand, so I'll try and block him off if he does get behind me, you know? And he probably ran twice the distance I did, chasing deer trails, doing all this stuff, just going 100 miles an hour. But he was in front of me, and as we were about a quarter mile from the truck, you know, we're on this trail, and it's just this, and I look down, and every so often I'm seeing these little red spots on the trail. And, you know, it's like, oh, barrier, this, that, and the other thing. And finally, I'm like, who is along here that was bleeding at some point? Because, man. And then it hit me. I wonder what his feet look like. I wonder what Moses' feet look like. And the dog champed out. I mean, he could have gone all day. Don't get me wrong. He could have gone all day. But we got him back home, and you know, I wiped him down and stuff like that. Every one of his feet was cut open at some point, you know. He had a mark, he had a gash, big gash on his one elbow, I think on his front leg, or maybe it was his hind leg, I think it was, that was cut open, stuff like that. And I look at it and I go, man, that dog is hardcore. You see, running and being out in the woods is that dog's passion. It's his passion. It's what he loves more than anything. And it's fun to be out there with him because he's literally grinning from ear to ear from the second we hop in the truck to the second we get back. You can see, you know what I mean, it is to see a smile on an animal's face. He is grinning. His tail is going all over the place. And the fact that this dog was literally running for probably about 2 hours with bloody feet mattered to him, but not enough to deter him from what he wanted to do. Because every time a deer trail crossed our path, he was sniffing it into the woods. Every time we saw people out hiking, he was running over to say hi. Everything in his life revolved around his passion for being out in the woods, and he wouldn't let nothing deter him from it, including literally bloody feet. And I'm going, man, what if my faith looked like that? What if your faith looked like that? What if our faith looked like that? That's what I think about when I read this passage. Let's bow our heads. Father, thank you. Thank you for your word. Like I said earlier, may our interpretation of it be honest and truthful. May you speak to our souls through this passage. Meet us where we're at and change us. Help us to know that you are real, that Satan is real, and that there is a war being fought for our souls. May we never back down because of our faith in your Son, Jesus Christ, and your love for us. We ask these things in Christ's name. Amen.